Hello and welcome to Grace Lutheran Church Sermon Podcasts. On this podcast, you will hear the latest sermons taken from our weekly worship service. Our hope is that you will find joy and comfort in knowing the forgiveness of God through Jesus Christ.
Lent is a somber time, and although we know this season ends in joy, don't we? Yes? No? Yes, Christ is risen. Your Savior is alive. But in Lent, you take the time to focus on repentance and your need for what you know is coming on Easter. Lent is part of your journey toward eternity with Christ. Paul says in Romans, God's patient kindness towards all those living is meant to lead you to repentance. So during this time of year, you reflect on you and your life with a repentant heart. And obviously, your repentance should be sincere, not just going through the motions, for God searches all our hearts. In a nutshell, Lenten repentance is done knowing with confidence that God forgives those who look up to Him. John's Gospel passage for today presents you with two reminders to carry you through your Lenten journey. One, you remember your sins. Two, you look upon the cross of Christ for the forgiveness of those sins. Now, there's a passage from the prophet Ezekiel that our women's Bible study group ran across recently that helps to visualize these two reminders. You remember your sins, and you look upon the cross of Christ for the forgiveness of those sins. Here's what Ezekiel prophesies. The Lord says, "Therefore, Ezekiel, say to the house of Israel, this is what the sovereign Lord says. Because of your sin and the abominations of your wayward lives, it is not for your sake that I am about to act, but for the sake of my holy reputation, which you profaned among the nations. Wherever you went, I will magnify my great name, and the nations who know what you have done will know that I am the Lord. And I will take you from among the nations and gather you from all the countries. I will purify you with water. I will clean you from your sin, purify you from your idols. I will give you a new heart and a new spirit. I will remove your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh, and I will put my spirit within you so that you may follow me and live like my children. On that day, you will live in the land I gave to your fathers, and you will be my people, and I will be your God. I will multiply you in the fruit of your labor, the trees and the produce, that you will never suffer the disgrace of famine again. Then you will remember your evil behavior. You will loathe yourselves on account of your sins, your abominable deeds. And you will then understand that it is because of what, of you, not because of you that I have saved you, but because of who I am." This text speaks not only to Israel, but also to you and me, for that prophecy of salvation, healing, and forgiveness promised to Israel is sealed with Christ's blood in the new covenant, only to be fully revealed at the end of time when God's kingdom descends and eternal life with Christ becomes a reality. But though you have been reconciled with God through Christ and sealed in this forgiveness through baptism, you are still flesh, you are still bone, and God tells even you and me, as he told Israel, you will remember your sins. And we do. We do remember our sins, what we've done wrong. Only we know. But long before God spoke to Ezekiel, we read in the book of Numbers that the Lord had this same problem with Israel's abominations and rebellious life. In fact, the whole Old Testament is filled with back and forth, confession and then forgiveness. Israel had just left Egypt in the book of Numbers and were wandering through the desert, complaining against God. We don't have bread. We don't have water. My feet hurt. I'm tired. Moses, it's all your fault. You've brought us here to die. We'd rather be back in Egypt as slaves. At least there we weren't responsible for our actions. At least the gods of Egypt gave us bread and water. Hey, let's make a golden calf and worship it. Perhaps it will give us what we want. Fed up with their sins, God then sent fiery serpents among the people, and they bit the people so that many people of Israel died. Talk about doing something that came back to bite you in the end. They began to grieve. They were more than just downcast. It is doubtful that they would have any difficulty to painfully remember their sins, much less God telling them that they will. Well, what did Israel expect? Scripture says the wages of sin is death. So now, after experiencing God's justice through poisonous snakes, they realize who they are and what they have done in God's eyes. The Israelites are desperate for a solution. There is no escaping God's punishment of snakes, the poison, and death. The people are desperate, as were the prison guards in the book of Acts, if you remember, when they discovered that God had opened the prison gates and Paul was set free. Knowing they would be killed for allowing Paul to escape, they cry out to Paul, "What must we do to be saved?" I don't know about you, but I have no problem remembering my sins. Do your sins haunt you, although they are forgiven? Do they come back to bite you like poisonous snakes when you least expect it? They lie coiled just around the corner in your mind, waiting for your weak moment in life to strike. Hey, remember when you did that? Hey, you shouldn't be so happy. Did God really forgive you? To accuse, to poison, to make you sad, grieve, loathe yourself, even though all the while knowing you have been healed by Christ's wounds. That's Lent. The Lord sent the snakes to punish the people for their sins. But consciences work just as well. I bet you too can relate to the prison guard's desperate cry, and I bet you can relate to the being bitten by snakes in your conscience. You were caught in the act, realizing who you are and what you have done, the shame you feel when you look in the mirror or when you're called out for something. As you remember your sins, you grieve. They're poisonous. Poison courses through your veins, and they are still real. The snake's bite, that painful bite of guilt and conscience, is sharp. Isn't it true that when you know the wrong you have committed before the Lord, harming those around you, it's a little more than just a sting or a slap on the hand? That conscience becomes poisonous and deadly. Like poison, guilt and sadness can course through your veins and eat away at your joy, eat away at your life. Sometimes it nags and gnaws so much you're unable to think of anything else. Many years ago, my first cousin was bit by a rattlesnake on her farm. She was rushed to the hospital. She survived, but the poison ate away at the skin and muscle tissue surrounding the wound. She still experiences stomach and digestive problems now, some 50 years later. That's the effect of your rebellion against God and living as a child. The pain of knowing who you are when you fall, when you fail to live as his child, just keeps eating away at your conscience. And like the prison guards, like the people of Israel, you too want to get rid of the guilt, the pain you've caused others, save your life, make it right. But try as you might, you can't suck the poison out. It runs through your veins. It infects the total you. You need to see a doctor. In his first letter to the Corinthians, Paul confronted the congregation with their sin of their liberal and pagan lifestyle. In his second letter, he wrote, "Now I rejoice not because you were grieved and downcast, but because this grief and sadness led you to repentance. For you felt a godly grief." Grief leads to sadness, downcast, and desperation because you don't know what to do. Ultimately, it can lead to despair, loss of hope, loss of comfort, and healing cannot take place. But godly grief, on the other hand, is grief that drives you to repentance, to know who you are and where to go. It drives you to look up to the cross of Christ, knowing that the poison of your sinful life will course through your veins until that cleansing blood of Christ heals you. Godly grief to repentance leads you to the only place where your sins and the memory of those sins are forgiven, and healing can take place. But as you remember your sins, God remembers his covenant of salvation. When Moses raised up the bronze serpent, everyone who looked up on it was saved. Everyone who was downcast looked up to the pole and was saved from death. Jesus uses this event in Numbers and fulfills it in himself to reveal your only hope, your only way to be saved. Jesus says, "As Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life." Whereas in the Garden of Eden, a snake brought sin and death and suffering, so this sinless snake, Jesus, is appointed and sent to bring you salvation and life and heal your poisonous wound, your grief, your sin, your conscience, to lift you up with his righteousness. He would be raised up on the cross so that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. We can only imagine how the Israelites looked up to the bronze serpent, but with just as much earnestness, with just as much desperation for eternal life, you lift up your eyes to Jesus. John says, "And when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." Jesus said this to show what kind of death he was going to die. Christ is the doctor that cures your snake bite. Waste away no longer. Look up to him who carries your pain, your sorrow, your desperateness, your shame, your sadness. High and lifted up. It's his blood that washes you clean, his blood that purifies you. It is his resurrected life that now courses through your veins. This week and for the rest of your life, as you journey home to God, you will live with these two reminders: remembering your sins and remembering your salvation. That's just the way it is. You hear great uplifting things on Sunday, but then Monday comes. You may feel grief. You may be depressed. You may be downcast during the week. That's why we're here on Sundays. It's easy to remember your sins, but sometimes they can lead to despair unless you're focused upon the cross of Christ. You remember your sin, but you're invited to leave it at the cross of Christ and in the tomb where he died. Leave downcast behind. Look up in hope to Jesus. A Lutheran pastor by the name of Dr. August Menicki told this story about his grandson in a book called Devotions for the Chronologically Gifted. Our daughter shared a conversation she overheard at home. Our 3-year-old grandson was standing at the basement stairs trying to muster enough courage to make the descent. Before taking the first step, he said, "Oh, Jesus, it's awful dark down there. You'd better hold my hand." When something grieves you this week and has you downcast, be it yourself or any hopeless situation, look up, ask Jesus to take your hand. The American poet John Greenleaf Whittier, a Quaker and slavery abolitionist in the mid-1800s, put it yet another way in a beautiful poem. A tender child of summer's three, seeking her little bed at night, paused on the dark stair timidly. "Oh, mother, take my hand," she said, "and then the dark will all be light." We older children grope our way from dark behind to dark before, and only when our hands we lay, dear Lord, in thine, the night is day. Reach downward to the sunless days, wherein our guides are blind as we, and faith is small and hope delays. Take thou the hands of prayer we raise, and let us feel the light of thee. Leave downcast behind. Psalm 42, why are you cast down, O my soul, and why are you in turmoil within me? Hope in God, for I shall again praise him, my salvation and my God. Amen.
To know more about Jesus and our ministry at Grace Lutheran Church, please find us at www.gracealoneonline.org. You'll find additional sermon podcasts and your favorite podcast channel every week at www.gracealoneonline.org/sermons.